My question focuses on the criminal justice system. We've all talked about and heard about the impact of the crime bill in the 1990s that created the sort of era of mass incarceration that exists today, that's been so damaging to communities across the country. Sort of two questions. I mean, if you could go back in time and change that crime bill, what would you do? But more importantly, if you are elected, what type of legislation, what type of federal legislation would you propose to reform our criminal justice system? To both, you know, improve the policing in this community and end the violence that we've just been talking about in a just way. So again, 2 minutes on what criminal justice reforms in the federal government would you specifically propose if you are elected to Congress? And I'm gonna first ask Mr. Williams a 2 minute answer, please.
Yes, well, you first started off saying, what is it would have been done differently in reference to the crime bill? I think my former boss, Bill Clinton, admitted himself that he made a mistake. I think mandatory minimums were a huge mistake. I think locking people up for crack cocaine compared to powder cocaine and having those guidelines for sentencing being very different was a huge mistake. One of the things I think that we need to look at, though, as we move forward is to figure out how it is we keep people out of the criminal justice system. It's one of the things I commend Cy Vance on doing. He did an event at my house, actually, with about 60 community people, talking about how it is we continue to try to keep people out of the criminal justice system by not taking people for doing minor offenses like drunken turnstile and other things like that. But when we talk about criminal justice reform, it's one of the few things now in Washington, D.C., where you actually see Republicans and Democrats alike actually agreeing that we need to do something different. It's unfortunate that a state like Texas is even in the forefront of criminal justice change because they realize it costs more to incarcerate people than it does to educate people. And so one of the things I think is important, there's an organization called the Vera Institute of Justice. They have a program, a very good friend of mine named Nick Turner runs that organization. They have a program called the Pathway Project. And what they do is they have a 5-year grant that they've given out to states to make certain that we have educational opportunities for inmates. So they're sitting there idle. One of the things that's been proven time and time again, if people have the ability to get an education while they're incarcerated, they typically have a much lower recidivism rate. And so this is a very much a worthwhile project. Right now is a grant program and project that's only in North Carolina, New Jersey, and Michigan. But it's the kind of program I would push to make certain on a federal level we get more funding for it so we can do a model program not just in New York but across the country so we can figure out how it is we keep people out of prison, one, and if they do go to prison, how it is we educate them so they have a lesser chance of going back to prison.
Thank you very much. Mr. Gallagher, you next. Your specific federal reforms in terms of criminal justice that you would advocate.
I would say the same thing about mandatory minimums. I'm not much for counterfactual questions in the sense that, like, what you can go back and change, but the idea that judges have no discretion, that mandatory minimum sentences over, I mean, we know, we read every day about people who are in jail for stealing $30 worth of whatever for life, let alone the sort of now drug trafficking, again, is exalted by federal prosecutors if it's not necessarily a giant amount of drugs. It's the third time that someone is convicted of something, they go away for life. There are people in jail over nonviolent drug offenses for life in the United States, and that is, it's intolerable. So I think that is the primary thing that I would concentrate on. I also think that while the money was given to police, I'm not sure the money was given to training. That we need police on. We want a good community police force, but we also want them to be trained to use their tools and not just guns. It's not just about guns. If you look in other countries, I mean, the UK, most police do not carry guns. We have an epidemic of gun violence that I think we, the police, don't need military vehicles in this country. They don't need assault weapons for every department and every part. I mean, the United States government sells old military weapons to police departments. What is the point of that? Is that really what we have come to? I don't believe that that is the solution to social problems in the United States, is more violence from the authorities. So my you know, primary thing is about mandatory minimums. And I would also say that I think that bail reform in the United States is an essential thing for I mean, we know historically Browner in New York, that someone could die in a prison in the United States having not been allowed out for bail after several years.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Assemblyman Wright, again, what would your specific proposals be for federal criminal justice reform?
Well, thank you so much for the question. Let me just say this. Michelle Alexander, in her book, talks about how mass incarceration is the new slavery. And that's really what's going on. In terms of the crime bill, I think it was 1994 crime bill, I said, even Bill Clinton has talked about how we made some mistakes, but let's remember the times that we were in. That was during the three strikes, you're out era, crack was decimating our communities, so there were some elected officials that felt that the crime bill was necessary. The crime bill, what I would do differently in terms of answering your question is that I would make sure that there was more money. I know there were added 100,000 police officers, I think, on the street. What I would do differently is make sure we had more programs for our young people, especially in our inner cities, to make sure, to answer your question about the crime bill. Certainly, you know, judges do need more discretion. Judges are handcuffed. The Eighth Amendment of the Constitution of the United States talks about how bail should be used basically just for people to show up in court. It should not be used in a punitive fashion at all. And it is because we have the wrong judges, and we also have judges that have no discretion. We also have to look at the sentencing guidelines in terms of our people being being punished for, in terms of sentencing disparities, in terms of crack cocaine versus powder cocaine, and also in terms of marijuana. Marijuana, people are being locked up for small amounts of marijuana. So these are the things that I would look at in terms of our criminal justice reform.
Thank you so much. Ambassador Cook, again, the same question. How would you have changed the crime bill from the 1990s, and then what would you do today?
Thank you for the question. I want to duly note that I was the only one who honored the bell the first time. Okay, I just want to note that. So I get 15 extra seconds on all my questions.
A higher power is tracking all this.
I see the whole thing in terms of prevention, serving time, and post time in terms of reentry. And certainly, as President Clinton indicated, there were problems with the crime bill. And so I would stand in agreement with him that there were problems with the crime bill. I was with Loretta Lynch last week, both at the White House and also when she was at David Deacon's series of lectures at Columbia University. And she talked about reform, rehabilitation, and reentry. And that's how I would look at the three new R's that America needs to deal with. Number one, prior to going into prisons, I'm a mother of two sons, so I look very carefully. It's one of my number one platform issues at the disproportionate number of black and brown men that are in prison. But the tracking starts in third grade. So if we do not get the educational system and the programs for young people together before they go into prison, then we're gonna have more prisoners going in. So we have to look at the educational system and, as Keith Wright says, programs for our young people. While they're serving time, it has, in today's Metro, it talked about those who study the classics and other educational tools actually have a 2% recidivism rate as opposed to those who have no education and they continue to go back and the cycle begins. Post, as they leave, if they've done the time, they should be able to be reentered into our communities with the support system that they need. They are left out with a Metro card at 6 a.m. and they're told, go and live a good life. There is no way that someone can live like that. So we have to work on the reentry, putting them with families, having centers and homes, halfway homes, where they can come and be assimilated back into communities, and having families that are ready to support them. So we have to look at pre, during the time, post time, and when you serve the time, you have to do it. Also, the decriminalization of marijuana and small crimes. And also, we don't know about the number of women. Okay, I'm gonna take my 15 seconds for the bell. The number of women who are put in prison because they won't testify against their boyfriends. So I would look at that differently. And I'm gonna stop. I'm gonna honor the bell.
Mr. Powell, how would you have changed the crime bill and what would you do if elected?
Yes, the crime bill had several portions of it, which really were no good. The three strikes you're out, the mandatory minimums, The death penalty, which obviously I'm always will be against, it's used in a discriminatory fashion against the poor, against minorities, and removing Pell Grants. All right, even President Bill Clinton has admitted that some of these things were a mistake, like the removal of the Pell Grants and the mandatory minimums. I would work with my colleagues in Congress to pass the REAL Act, REAL, which stands for Restoring Education and Learning, which means that it would bring the Pell Grants back to people who are incarcerated. Congresswoman Donna Edwards from Maryland is the lead sponsor. And moving forward, I think it's important to continue this movement of banning the box. Banning the box is a movement whereby, you know, when you have to have a job application, you have to check off whether you've been incarcerated or not, whether you have a record or not. Okay, 22 states have banned the box, including New York. We must do that on a national level, because we have 65 million people in this country with a felony record who are being branded for life. I mean, they really can't get a real job. And with those types of questions and with that type of record, you know, they won't be able to advance. And that's why the incarceration rate from the 1994 era when the crime bill was passed to today has gone up four times, from 500,000 to well over 2.3 million people are incarcerated today. That's four times more than China. And they have a whole lot more people than we do. That's more than the 35 top European nations combined. We need to stop incarcerating people, folks. We are the richest nation on earth. We should not be incarcerating people each and every day. We need to give them an opportunity, and small level drug offenders and otherwise need to be given opportunities, not being branded for life.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The mistakes in the crime bill, and again, your specific changes if you're elected in Washington.
I think the law is basically one that is extreme in that it really puts people away for good and throws away the key as though that was a solution. And I believe that I would separate minor offenses from the hardcore violent individuals that need to be approached differently, number one. Number two, yesterday, hundreds of young people went to Albany to support a legislation trying to do away with solitary confinement that has taken the life of so many. Assemblyman Aubrey and Senator Perkins are the lead. They are one of the sponsors. But to hear the testimony of young people that were detained and how they explain how dehumanizing that experience is. It's like taking away your sense of humanity when they put you away forever. And I think in many ways, those were just voices of those who have survived, but there are so many scars of young people that will take their entire life. And I say, we need to really change the paradigm and take this from being a business, for-profit business in this country. This is what it is, let's call it for what it is. And let's begin to invest in our young people, in our community, and in our families. I work with Exodus in East Harlem, trying to bring it to North Manhattan in the re-entry effort to really avoid having repeat, then going back. And I think this is the way that we need to really rally our families and our communities to really safeguard our students. I will bring resources just precisely focusing on that and have the community engage and make a difference.
Hey, Mr. Williams, is a rebuttal statement?
Well, I'd like to add one more thing. I think that you're right to ask the question about the federal government, but we also need to focus on the state government. The federal government has a little bit more than 211,000 people incarcerated. The overwhelming majority of people, almost 1.5 million people in America, are incarcerated in state prisons. And so unless we have a real conversation also about what needs to be done on the state level, we're not having a real conversation at all about justice reform and about prison reform. And so we also need to look at what states individually can do to bring about real change on this issue also.
Thank you. Any other? Yeah.
One of the things we've done at the state level was the repeal of the Rockefeller drug laws. Yes, We have already seen, and by the way, I don't know, and I don't know how many know, but Rockefeller, Governor Rockefeller, in his zealous ambition to become president and appear to be tough on crime, he wanted to actually make mandatory life sentences. Yeah. The Rockefeller drug laws were a compromise, quote unquote, compromise of sorts, and they were devastating. And already we have seen, by the repeal of the Rockefeller drug laws, the levels of incarceration in New York State, at least, have gone down dramatically. And already Governor Cuomo and others are leading an effort to close some of our jails because, you know, fortunately we have been emptying some of the jails that have been built in the 80s. Thank you.